Right, so we start with our second module, wireless propagation and its effect. I think it's coming there. So, till now what we have done is that we have touched upon cellular architecture, okay? We have gone through the details of cellular design. But one thing we haven't taken into consideration that what happens with the channel. Because we always have a base station, we always have a mobile device somewhere, and in between there was nothing except for a channel, but we haven't configured that channel till this point. So from this time onward, we are taking the channel into consideration, and we will try to make sure that the randomness of the channel, if we can take that into some modeling, okay, some kind of an approximation we can consider, so that the transmitter and the receiver, the behavior of transmitter and receiver can be made a bit better. By that what we mean is, when we are looking at a scenario such as this, when you have a transmitter somewhere, placed somewhere here, and you have a receiver remotely placed somewhere at a remote location, now what is happening then? The idea is that we are trying to transmit something, a data or a signal, whatever it is, and it should be properly replicated at the receiver. So that's what the main idea is. But till now what we have assumed is that whatever is being sent from a transmitter, it should come in that same manner to the receiver, which is a very hypothetical assumption for that matter. Okay? So in this case what is happening ideally, more a practical solution scenario is, that the transmitter will try to go on transmitting it, and it will go on having different sets of attenuations, okay? It will go on having different sets of attenuation by hitting this obstacle somewhere. So it might hit this building, which is a blue color, and it might come rebound and hit this car somewhere, okay? So this car is the receiver. Suppose the user is at the receiver and he is sitting on the car, okay? So all these users who are roaming somewhere, they might create an obstacle. The building might create an obstacle. Okay, this buildings might create another obstacle. This nature, okay, the nature will also create some amount of obstacle, because there might be a hilly terrain or might be a tree. Okay, so all those things will come into picture. So what we are observing is that instead of a connection such as this, which I am pointing out by four arrows, which we call sometimes as the line of sight. Now we are having more than line of sight communication, where we have multiple non-line of sight process. So these all are non-line of sight communication. So what it effectively does is that at the receiver, we are actually receiving multiple copies of the same transmitted signal. And that's in a way is a problem, because if our device is not good enough to distinguish between the original or the desired signal to that of a noise, it will try to replicate or it will try to amplify the noise itself. So what we are going to do is, in this particular module, is that we know what do we have as transmitter, because that's a user built thing, as well as if the device is somewhere here, this is also as the receiver we know, but this other quantities like A or B or C or the D part, these are all unknown. And we cannot really go on doing anything for this, because we cannot go and check the building, that we have to demolish that building because we are not getting a signal. We cannot go and just demolish some hilly terrain because it is obstructing to our nature. No, usually it's not done, right? So you cannot really change all this. So what we are going to do is, this A, B, C, D, whatever be it, this can be considered to be fitting in some model. Okay, and that's where the multipath propagation models comes in. Now naturally, if you can imagine the scenario, which will come in detail at a later stage, which you can imagine that being in outdoor, okay, just understand the statement, being in outdoor, the resultant measurement using a model will be different to that of measuring the same for the indoor environment. And here what we are measuring is mostly power or receive power. What I said, measuring in outdoor environment will be completely different to that of the one that we are going to do for the indoor environment. Why? Because the outdoor environment will produce, or outdoor environment will have different sets of attenuators. For example, the trees or the hilly terrain that you have, you cannot really experience this in the indoor environment, right? Or again, as far as indoor environment is concerned, suppose you are trying to measure the received power within this particular room. Now what do we have here is this benches. Now these benches or wooden benches or the whatever the framework we have, it's not there in the outdoor environment, right? So we have certain kind of outdoor propagation model, and we have also something like an indoor propagation model. We'll come to this outdoor and indoor at the later stage, post cat 1, most probably. But this is what the basic idea is. Because to account for the randomness of the channel, we need to have a model where we can fit in the datas, okay? Because most of these models which you will come across, you will find many of them are empirical models. They are not analytical models. So that means that we have gone on experimenting it, and then we got some result. Based on that, we have kind of extrapolated the equation. Kind of that kind of thing we'll observe. So what we'll have is we'll go on setting the data. We'll go on measuring the data. We'll fit in those data in that equation, and we will claim that how much is the channel effective when we have a transmitter and the receiver. Because the randomness of the channel is so much, we cannot really predict the nature of a channel. But we have to take into account because of the non-line of sight nature. We cannot really restrict our discussion to only line of sight. So that's the basic idea behind all these modules. So starting from this module, everything till that point we go till GSM, everything will be based on the channel modeling itself. So there can be multiple number of losses which we can observe in this way, like the absorption losses which I already told you, that basically this is a penetration loss. Okay. So when the signal passes through any medium, okay, this will be penetrated, amount of portion will be attenuated a lot. Maybe we call that the propagation losses, so in that way also you will find reflection, diffractions happening to the same signal, and maybe the radio front, the free space, okay, by naturally expansion of radio waves, in free space, there should be a dissipation of the power. Just like we know that when we are going away from the base station, there is always a decrease in the power, amount of power that we have. And naturally, we will require a handoff for that matter, okay? So that is in itself is an idea or an example of a propagation loss. Now coming to diffraction loss, this will, I'll come to a detail a bit more later on. But for the time being, let us assume that it is basically one of the losses that is caused by obstruction by sharp objects. We'll see that what exactly it is by coming to this slide. This is what I was talking about, that with the different set of materials that we have, each one of them has its own nature of fading or attenuation. Just for example, you can see turn corner in corridor. We even don't know, like we always do it. Even if you go out of this room and you are turning a corridor, you never are aware of this. But actually it will count, if it goes that way, it will count almost around 10 to 15 dB of attenuation at a particular frequency. Now this is only for 1.3 GHz. Now suppose you are working on 2.4 GHz, it will have a different set of attenuation. But the important aspect is there is an amount of attenuation happening. Even with the simplistic plywood, which we even don't know that causes this many number of attenuation, we can see there is an amount of attenuation that is happening in loss. Okay? So that's a beauty, that whenever we are observing any obstacle of any material, that will add to the loss to the overall system. So in this particular segment, we are going to account for that loss. How much of the loss is happening? So if I can neglect that loss from the received signal, we can get, or if we can add, if we can guess that loss from the model somehow, then we can eliminate that loss. So we get a perfect receiver at our received signal at the output. So this is some kind of an example. We'll come to that later in a more detail when we go for indoor propagation model. You will find that there are several models that only differs because of the material that we are going to use. We'll come to that later. Now this is a very interesting observation, which these are fundamental propagation mechanisms which we all know from physics. But as far as RF communication is concerned, they are defining a different way. So please note down the first line which is mentioned over here about reflection, diffraction and the scattering, which will come in next slide. So in reflection, what is happening over here is, see, reflection is what we all know. Okay, that's nothing to worry about. But here, if you are asked to find out or define reflection with respect to the RF communication, basically what we are looking at is when the obstruction or the foliages, okay, have a dimension, physical dimension that is, much, much greater than that of the wavelength of the signal, then that particular phenomena is called as the reflection. For example, if you, okay, I have the example itself. So if you can observe here that we have f as 900 frequency, okay, 900 as a frequency. So if we try to calculate the lambda, that is the wavelength, it's coming around 0.33 meters. Now if you consider a wall or a building, the dimension of the building, physical dimension of a building or a wall is much, much greater compared to this 0.33 meters. Even for 1800 megahertz, the dimension is much lesser compared to the dimension of the building. For example, you just take an example, like if you consider TT as a building. So that building has a size much greater than the wavelength at which the signal is coming and impinging on it. So definitely the building, TT building, will have a role to play for the reflection loss happening to the signal. Okay, and it goes for anything, like for example, as I told you, building, wall, or whatever it is, because everything is more compared to this type of wavelength. So that is, please remember this, that what happens with reflection, because it's a different definition to that of what we know of physics. Okay, so this is from the dimension perspective, obstruction perspective. The next point, and you will find that actually reflection and the scattering is opposite to it, opposite to that. When the dimension will have equal or if not smaller dimension compared to the wavelength, that we will call as scattering. We will come to that. The next part is the diffraction. Okay, again, diffraction we know all from the knowledge of physics, but here with respect to RF communication, diffraction is defined as the transmitter and receiver is obstructed by a surface that has a sharp irregularities, or we call sometimes this as knife edge. This is what the fundamental idea behind the derivation of knife edge geometry at some point. So this is knife edge. This is sharp. Okay, please point out this. So basically what we are looking at is that, suppose this building is there. Suppose this is a building. So what will happen that rays, if it comes over here, the walls of the building will create a reflection, will actually add to the reflection. But this particular zone, which has these sharp irregularities, this will have a diffraction. Understood? So that's why reflection plus diffraction, if not scattering along with it, all together will add to the total propagation loss for a signal. What we are discussing is all the losses, the natural phenomena that happens, okay? Because that's how the whole the process of signal transfer will happen, okay? So this is reflection, and the next one is a diffraction, and the diagram actually gives you why we are looking at diffraction. So this particular H is what is responsible. So even if you can go to, like, you can just observe in TT, when you outside that, when you are taking the road just beside the food court, and you are coming towards the Balaji store, that road, if you are coming, you will find that there are sharp edges that comes out of TT as per the building construction. So those sharp edges also will add to the diffraction of the signal itself. And you will soon find, when we will discuss on the model, that actually diffraction is a helpful phenomenon. And that is one of the reason why rural areas are getting connected, or rather they in rural areas, we usually get hooked onto the signal or the mobile communication, mobile signals for that. We'll see that later. Now we are looking at scattering, right? Now we are having a scattering over here. Now this scattering is, again, as I told you, it's opposite to reflection. In this case, the dimension is smaller or comparable to the wavelength of the signal. And that's, for example, what is happening, that the millimeter waves, okay, millimeter waves wavelength if we have, so the more the higher frequency you are coming, going in a way, so raindrop starts to interact. Raindrop, fog, snow, all these things starts to interact with this particular waves. But on the other hand, 900 megahertz carrier frequency will not be harmed that much. So it depends on entirely on the frequency band or frequency at which you are working and the nature of obstacle that you have. So this all adds to the brilliance of non-line of sight communication process. All this adds to it. Another thing that adds to this three phenomena is something called as the frequency dependence. As I told you already that it's already established that frequency has a role to play. Definitely will have a role to play. And here one important aspect is power falls very sharply with the distance from the source. That's the one of the main problems that we encounter, and that's one of the reasons why require a handoff. Because when you are going away from the base station, the distance is going on increasing. So that's where we are actually heading towards, that there should be a relationship where the received power will be a function of the distance. So that by using the distance, we can actually predict the amount of received power that we have, based on which we can actually set the threshold at some point of time. Understood? So that's where we are heading towards. So this is some of the properties of radio waves also. Next is what we call is, we will discuss with this. We call this something called as small scale and large scale fading. Okay. Now this small scale and large scale fading we'll discuss a little bit more post CAT 1 when we are going into detail of outdoor and indoor model. But for the time being, let us at least understand the concept from the definition point of view. So there can be two types in which the measurement can be made. Okay. And these two types, one is the small scale, where small scale fading deals with mobile station moving very slowly within a very small distance, and you are going on taking instantaneous measurement of the power received. Okay. Now if you are taking that, what is happening that for the duration of time, you are actually making sure that there is an instantaneous fluctuation that is happening of the signal, which is quite obvious because you are going from, suppose you start to measure from gate number 1 and you are going till the SJT. And each and every time with each distance you are going on measuring the signal attribute and you are making a graph of it. The red one that you are observing over here is something kind of that small scale fading nature, where we are taking an instantaneous fluctuation and we are rapid and arbitrary data are coming in that form. In some cases we will actually require a small scale analysis, and for that nature the small scale fading is important. Whereas when we take a local average of it, okay, and for a duration of time, when we are taking a local average of the whole set of data that we have observed, that comes as the large scale fading, which is coming over here. Here it is given by the blue line. So basically, one is within a very short duration, very arbitrary fluctuation, instantaneous values that we are taking, and the other one is something where we are taking an average of the whole. So average, naturally it won't be that less or not, it will be not more, but it will be in between somehow. So it depends. So this is what we call a small scale and large scale fading. We'll come to the detail of this at some later stage, post-CAT one. Now more important to today's discussion is this one, which is known as the free space propagation model. I told you in the first slide that we will try to have or try to develop a model where we will fit in the data and we will predict the nature of fading, whatever is happening. So the same nature, we consider this particular equation as a basic to start with. Now most of you, I don't know how many of you have done satellite communication, how many of you have done it satellite now? So you must be aware of this equation somehow, because this is a very common equation that is used in satellite communication. Why? Because of the LOS links. So one of the biggest assumptions from this is that it works for an LOS scenarios. Now what is the equation tells us? It's basically P dot D on the left hand side, you can observe, which is again received power, but it's the function of D. D is the separation of transmitter and receiver. So the more we are separating, the D will vary. The more we are closer to base station or the transmitter, we are having a D different value. So that's where the D comes in. Now the rest of the things are pretty obvious, like PT, GT, GR. GT, GR are the gain of both the transmitter and the receiver antenna. PT is the transmitted power, lambda is the wavelength of the signal, again it depends on C by F as a formula. For people who are not that much familiar with it, again forgotten or something like that. So lambda is given by C by F, F is given by the carrier frequency at which we are operating. So 900 MHz will have different lambda, 2.4 GHz will have different lambda like that. Now everything is constant except for that in a numerator we have something as D square. So basically, with respect to distance, we are trying to plot what is VRT. Okay? So that is what being given over here. Very simple, very generic expression for this, and it's a common expression or a model where we use it for LOS communication, for satellite communication, or microwave links you can observe, and even for wireless communication. Okay. Now, if you know this, and another very important expression in this is there, and that is this one, G equal to, which is the gain. Okay, the general gain of the antenna is given by 4 pi A AU. A is the aperture of the antenna itself divided by lambda square. It will be very useful at some time later on while solving the problems. Okay, so keep this formula with you, especially the formula this PTGT GR lambda square by 4 pi whole square T square L. This is a common, like if you go on practicing it, you will remember it. So it's not that difficult. L is a factor which is L, mostly in numericals or in most of our assumption, we'll consider that to be 1. L is considered to be the system loss. System loss is what? It is not the environmental loss. It is something like a filter is not working, or the electronic gadgets through which you are making a measurement, that has a loss. So those things is considered to be under system loss. And that, in most cases, if it is 1, then it is considered to be that the system is not faulty. That the, suppose the measuring device that we have, it's not faulty, it's absolutely calibrated problem. Kind of, that scenario. So L is always kept as 1 in most of the cases. Now if you have this, and if you have the slides, can anyone just tell me one thing? What are, this is a very important and important observation actually you have to find. What are the drawbacks of this equation? What are the two major drawbacks of this particular equation of the model which is called as free space model? You observe, you have the equation, you have the basic set of assumption and whatever it is. Can you cite any two major difficulties one would have in designing a wireless communication system using this particular model? That's correct. That one very important observation is that we are looking at LOS, and already I have established previously that LOS is not the only one to look out for. You have a non-line of sight communication. So one of the biggest drawbacks for this is that it is only applicable for LOS communication and not for long line of sight. Can you cite the other one? Can you cite any specific other problem that you might have on this model? Sorry? Yeah, that is always okay, because lambda anyways, like you have to include the frequency at some point of time. So naturally you are including that. So that's fine in a way. The major problem with this is, if suppose the transmitter and receiver separation is 0. Okay. If the base station and the user is right at the same point of time, and you want to apply the equation. So in that case, maybe D equal to 0 is what we are assuming, because D is what the transmitter receiver separation. But if we apply D equal to 0 to that equation of PRD, it becomes undefined, right? So that is one of the major problems with this. So if anyone asks you, well, what are the disadvantages or drawbacks of propagation model or free space model, LOS and the D equal to 0 factor, these two are the major drawbacks. Now what we have is, like, naturally if a drawback is there, we need to have a solution to it. So what we'll observe, that this LOS will be taken care of by something called as two-ray model. We'll discuss this on Wednesday. Okay, so two-ray model is what we are going to do, because two-ray model will deal with both line of sight plus non-line of sight. So both the line of sight and non-line of sight components will be taken care in two-ray model. That's where the term comes in as two-ray. One ray is for line of sight, the other ray is for non-line of sight. That's why it's a two-ray model. So that will be taken care of. But what happens to the D equal to 0? So we need some reference from where we will start. Okay? We cannot use the D equal to 0, so we need a reference point. To, in order to do that, there is a very, very interesting thing that happens. And that is what we call as front of a distance. Okay? So let's see what is that. This is what we call as far field region. Please pay attention to this. This is very interesting and a very crucial junction that we have. Now what is happening, see the first line, that the free space model or the free space model is an effective predictor. It's a predictor, okay? It might be wrong because non-line of sight is not taken care of. That's why it's a predictor. For received power for values of D which are far field of the transmitting antenna. Now what does this far field mean? This far field has a meaning. And that far field mean is that in that region of a transmitting antenna, beyond the far field distance DF, DF is given by this equation, DF equals to 2D square by lambda, where capital D is the largest physical dimension of the antenna being used. Okay, and lambda is once again C by F. So basically DF is a reference distance after which you can apply free space equation. So this far field distance or far field region, distance is nothing but the region, right? So that region needs to be defined using this particular equation. So that is what, in that region of transmitting antenna beyond far field DF, which is related to the largest dimension of the antenna and the wavelength, only when we are beyond DF, see the last point, only when we are beyond DF, if the receiver has farther moved away, then only we can use the free space equation. So we have two drawbacks. LOS was taken care by 2-ray model. D equal to 0 part was taken care of by a far field region like this. What is the significance of it? Let's see with a small numerical. Let's see. Let us have this as our formula. Please try to go and find out what is DF. Just small little problem you have. Your maximum dimension of the antenna is given as 1 meter. The frequency of operation is 900 megahertz and 1800. Let us have it for 900 first. And the corresponding equation is given also by DF as 2D square by lambda. So, calculate the value of DF in this case and comment on the result. This will actually give you an idea about why we are looking at it. So, since I have little less time today, I came late. So, let us pinpoint. So, D1 is this 900 megahertz DF. So, if you substitute and find that lambda, this is nothing but C by F. Yes, 3 into 10 to the power 8. Whereas this is 900 into 10 to the power 6. So this is meter per second and this is maybe. Okay. Let us not write this. We directly write 0.33 meters. And if you substitute to DF, DF is coming as 2.1 whole square divided by 0.33, which is coming almost 6.06 meters. Similarly, for 1800, if you calculate DF prime, if you calculate, this will come almost around 12 meters. So what does this mean? It means that with a given dimension of 1 meter of our antenna, if we wish to use the free space equation, okay, the receiver needs to go out, or the distance between the transmitter and receiver to be minimum 26 meter. For frequency of 900 megahertz. Only after 6 meter and beyond, we can apply a free space equation to it. And when it goes to 1800 megahertz, the separation between transmitter and receiver should be at minimum of 12 meters. And beyond that only we can use it. So that is the beauty of this particular nature. Understood. So this is what the main idea is. Very trivial equation, but it's a very significant one to eliminate the drawbacks. So if I go back once again, so now if it is clear with you, so this is what the main idea is. And naturally what you can observe, that if we consider the value of PF, okay, that's almost greater, that is mostly greater than what we are expecting for the lambda. Okay? So that kind of it will come directly from the equation itself. So that's where the two drawbacks have been removed. Now we come back to something called as the two parameters which are very important in the equation of free space, and that is, one is known as the PTGT, the factor that you have mentioned over there, Pt multiplied by Et, power into gain, this formula or this portion is known as EIRP or effective isotropic radiated power. If you don't understand that, that's why EIRP comes stands for effective isotropic radiated power. But in general, if you understand the significance of it, that actually gives us a maximum power from transmitter directed towards the receiver. What is the maximum power? This is basically power multiplied by the gain. Okay, so the more we feeding the power, the more the gain will be. So that's the multiplicative factor. That part is PTGT. The other factor that is important, which we can evaluate from this, is path loss. Please make a note of this equation of path loss, because in this path loss, what we are trying to do is we are nothing doing but we are taking a ratio. Okay, we are taking a ratio of transmitted power to that of the received power. So basically, we are doing PT by PR like this. Okay. So if you just check this particular equation, and if we want PT by PR, okay, we want to PT by PR. So what will it be looking like? It will be 4 pi whole square d square L divided by GT GR lambda square, right? From the equation given on the left with the red color, the one that I have mentioned, so this is what the equation will be. Now if you take a 10 log of it, okay, this PT whole thing 10 log of it, and you give a minus sign to it, how does it look like? This particular equation, how does it look like? It looks very similar to the free space equation, except that we don't have a PT out here. See, PT GT GR lambda square by 4 pi whole square d square L. L is supposed to be 1. So except for the PT part, everything looks very similar to that of the free space equation. So just to represent that in that way, we are taking a minus sign, minus 10 log of it, because path loss will always be in dB scale. So we have to take a 10 log of it so that it comes in dB. Now the question also comes in that what about that negative sign? Is that only coming because of the mathematics that we are doing? Yes, that is one correct answer. But the other portion is that we are trying to calculate a loss factor, okay, attenuation. So that negative sign kind of indicating the amount of loss that might have. So it's a negative term. Loss is always negative. So that's what the negative term is indicating. Okay, that's the significance of it. So that's how we are dealing with the generic term. And if you consider the unity gain, when the GT and GR are considered to be 1, in many of the cases you will find, we will consider GT and GR to be 1 to ease our calculation. So you just remove the GT GR from the equation. So you are left with 10 log minus 10 log lambda squared by 4 pi whole square d square. So that's with unity gain. So that's how you are trying to calculate the path loss. So if you now know the path loss, okay, you have a received signal. So received signal minus the path loss, you can actually come back with the transmitted signal. So that's how kind of a calculation we are trying to do. So this finding this path loss requires PR, and PR requires GT, GR, lambda square, or the free space equation, or a model, which has its own drawbacks. But we can actually feed in the data. Suppose the D, everything is known to you. GT, GR, lambda square, everything is constant, everything is known to you, except that you don't know about D. Now D is a variable because you are moving from one transmitter to receiver. So D is varying. So if you just substitute the varying value, you will get the amount of loss that might happen. So, and as I already told you, that this model is a predictor. So it predicts the amount of loss also. So if you can take that this amount of loss might happen, so I can take the action at the transmitter or at the receiver, so that even if that loss happens, we are not losing too much of the information. Because remember, transmitter and receiver both are with user. Transmitter is also developed by users, receiver is also some user kind of. The device that you are using is our receiver, as a user has made it, right? Someone has made it, it's not naturally occurring thing. So that's why keeping that loss, by calculating that loss, we can predict the optimization that we need to do both at transmitter as well as the receiver. Okay. So that's one of the observation out of it. This we have already touched upon. This also almost we have done the same thing where we needed a reference distance, as I told you. So this is a generic equation. You can see the middle one, the middle red one, PR in dBm. If you express it in dBm, okay, this is a very interesting part. I will come to that. dBm, the expression seems to be 10 log of PR d naught plus 20 log of d naught by d. Okay, that's how we are approximating it. So when we are considering that d naught is a reference distance, which again should be governed by the far off distance. So by calculating this, we see last line you can observe that it's 1 meter or 100 meters for an 1 meter for indoor environment. This is considered d naught, and 100 meters and 1 kilometers for an outdoor environment. So based on this, what we'll do is we'll fit the data for a reference distance. That what is the received power. Now we will calibrate it, extrapolate the data for a longer distance. So if we know it for 100 meters, what it will be for 10 kilometers or hundreds of kilometers, something kind of that. So that accounts to some of on this numerical, which will be the second one. We'll come to that. But before coming to that, let us take a little time in understanding this particular phenomenon. What is happening? Please understand it very carefully, because you remember in most of this discussion, whatever we are going to have, this will be dealt with power, received power, and it will be expressed in terms of dBm or dB watt. Okay. Now converting how you can do it easily is given by this particular example. Very small, trivial example, but please remember it, because if your units are wrong, your meaning is completely different. Okay. So in this case, suppose you are given a 50 watt of power. Is asked to express in units of dBm and dB watt, right? So what we are doing is basically we are multiplying 50 with respect to 10 to the power 3. We are converting that to milliwatt. Then we are taking 10 log of it, so that makes it dBm. Now the interesting fact is, if you subtract 30 from dBm, that gives you a value of dB watt. So this is where, this is a very interesting and important observation. Please keep a note of it, okay, this part. So in any given problem, what you have to do is, first you take it to milliwatt, okay. It's not always needed, but most of the problem you will observe that they will be considering or they will be asking you for dBm or dB watt, okay. So basically if you have milliwatt, you convert that to dBm. Then you subtract 30 out of it, so you will get something in terms of dB watt. So that is how the whole process works. So if you are comfortable with this, see the example. See, 47 dBm is the answer. Now suppose the question is to find in dB watt. So what will it be? 47 dBm minus 30. That will be the amount of dB watt. So that's very easy to compute, because the more the problems you will consider, you will find that this conversion will take a lot of time if you are not clear with it. So what I'll tell you, just remember one thing, convert everything to dBm and then minus 30 or plus 30 based on whichever you want. If you want to keep it at dBm, don't do anything. If you want to convert that in dB watt, subtract 30. Simple. Now to account for that, let us do one problem which was given in here. Okay. Can you just find me the PR for this? If a 50 watt is applied to an unity gain antenna, so unity gain antenna, GT, GR, everything is one, with 900 megahertz of carrier frequency, find the received power in dBm at free space distance of 100 meters from the antenna. Please observe, this 100 meter is nothing but the reference distance d naught, or d for that matter. So what we are going to do is, we will try to find out what is the received power at 100 meter. Then we are going to use that data to find out what is the power at 10 kilometers. Okay. So just substitute in that equation of PR equal to PT GT GR lambda square by 4 pi d square, and tell me the answer that you are getting for PR. So I am asking you to do. PR, so this is our formula, PT GT GR lambda square by 4 pi whole square d square L. L considered to be 1, so leave out L. your d in this case is 100 meters. So substitute according as per your units. Very important. Change all the units as per your requirements. Substitute it properly and give me the answer for PR in dBm. What you are getting in dBm. Because this will serve as a reference power in order to find it for 10 kilometers. What happened, Rahul? Do it. GTGR is considered to be 1, so you don't have to consider that. Lambda, anyway, it's 900 megahertz, so it will come around 0.33 once again. PT is 50. Okay. 4 pi whole square is constant. D is 100 meters, so you can keep it 100 meters. So whatever the answer you are getting, it should be in watt. Something you will get in watt. Because you are measuring a power, right? So again, the rule is from watt, convert that to milliwatt, take a 10 log of the whole thing, it will be dBm. So that's being asked to you. It's just a calculation, nothing else. A calculator, if you have, it's 2 minutes of substitution and getting the answer. One, you need a gain. So if I just, sorry, didn't get it. With a dBm. No, the answer is something else. I'll show you. 24.5. I think you have added something else. See this solution to it there. So you have this as an equation. So if you substitute each and every values to it, as I told you here, okay, so you are mentioning this as 50, this is 1, this is 1, lambda is 1 by 3 whole square, 4 pi whole square, this d is 100 meters, so that's whole square, l is 1 you are considering already. So if you substitute and go on calculating, you will be getting something in terms of watt, 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 6 watt. Then you convert that to milli watt, okay, so that's 3.5 into 10 to the power minus 3. Now you take the 10 log of the whole thing, so you are coming up with minus 24.5 dBm. Because you are asked to find in dBm. If suppose the question demanded you convert that to dB watt, minus 24.5 minus 30. That's what we dB watt. Okay. Now if you get, yes. No. Because when I told you that whenever you are trying to calculate with free space, you need a reference distance, d. Now initially, the d is given as 100 meters, it's very small. D naught will be very small, it's near to the base station or near to the transmitter. So that serves as a reference. So now if I get that 24 dBm, we can refer to that at 100 meters, the received power is minus 24 dBm. Right. Now, what will be the power at distance of 10 kilometers? So it's kind of a calibration kind of thing we are doing. So for that, you require that 100 meters. So using that, you have got the 24.0 dBm. So you will find this plus the new distance 10 kilometers in order to find the next set of solution. So next set of solution is nothing but this PR 100. Why we are writing this? Because if you just go back to one or two slides before, see this equation, the red one in middle. That is basically the modified equation with respect to free space. The same equation is what we are doing. In this case, PR D naught is the 24 dBm. And we are trying to calculate the 20 log of D naught by D. This D naught is 100 meters. Small d is 10 kilometers. So that reference point is important for free space. Okay. So that's where that's how we are using this equation, you see. That's where we are using the last slides. PR 100, so at 100 meter plus 20 log of d naught by d. So 100 meters, and we are converting 10 kilometers to 1 meter. So we are trying to use that. Because we are calculating everything with respect to dBm.
No, I get
that.
Dividing by
0.001. Yes.
Where is that?
10 to the power minus 3, no? That comes in as 10 to the power 3 when you are going out. Right. If you take this 0, this is divided by 0.001. If you make it in numerator, what will happen? Right, so that's what we are doing.
You see this problem, what we did?
15 to 10 to the power 3, same thing we are doing, it's just that it representation wise. So now you can see minus 24 dBm that we got from PR100 and then minus 40 dB we calculated from D0 by D. Hence the value is coming around minus 64.5 dBm. Again, if you wish to express that in what, dB what, you minus, make a minus 30 out of it. That will be the amount of dB what. Right? So this is where we end. We'll come back next day and we'll do the two-ray model. So this is one of the solutions we have done for free space. Two-ray is the last thing that we are going to do for before CAT 1. That will be there with your syllabus. Okay, so we'll do that next day.
Yeah,
that's
the next
one.
Yeah.